All right, so we're recording, and we'll do a little check here.
Check.
Check-a-rooty.
Check.
All right, well, welcome to Theater is Essential. I'm your host, Dr. William Bill Conte, Assistant Director of the Theater of the Poor, and with me is...
Julia Conte.
Who's also part of the Theater of the Poor, member of the ensemble, and my daughter. I'm very proud of
her. Board member.
Board member, yes. So, we're here today to talk about our recent experience producing a forgotten melodrama called The Senator, written by David D. Lloyd and Sidney Rosenfeld. What do you want to say about that, Julia?
We started working on The Senator with Joanna Wickman in April 2023. And we went through the scripts, and it was really fun.
Yeah, the melodrama was discovered by Joanna Wickman, this lovely historian from the Fort Casper Museum. And she found this in the course of her research on Senator Preston Plum, whom I have been calling Prescott.
Right.
But no, but anyway, in the course of her research on this book about this senator who had represented the Wyoming Territory, Joanna discovered this play. And the senator play is a melodrama that was written in the 1890s, and it was based on the character of Preston Plum, and that was transformed into a character named Senator Hannibal Rivers. At the time, in 1890, when the play was written, it was performed, the role was performed by William Crane, a famous American actor of his day. And subsequently, the play, yes, there he is. And subsequently, the play went on to become a success on Broadway and a success also touring around the country. So our task was to reproduce this thing, which we did. And Julia was an actor in this. She played Josie Armstrong, the lively girl of the melodrama. Mentioning the melodrama, this play has all of the stock characters, every one that you expect to find in the melodrama. You've got your hero, you got your heroine, your villain, the sidekick to the hero, which in this case is Mrs. Hillary. Another lively widow type character.
What makes it really appealing is like the ensemble of characters, because everybody is pretty like we've talked about this, all the characters are really fleshed out and have like their own stories, and they're really like, they're pretty deep characters. It's not just like one dude.
Yeah, everybody's got all the characters were of interest, and it was it's an interesting play all around. I mean, the character of Senator Rivers, which was based on Preston Plum, is an interesting study in the theater's representation of politics and politicians at the time. There is a lot of process represented in the play. The whole play centers around an unsettled claim of debt on the part of the descendant of a former military captain in the U.S. Navy during the War of 1812. And after 70 years, this has still not been resolved, and Senator Rivers comes along and he ends up saving the day.
Complicated maritime law plot
involving complicated international maritime law.
But that's the thing, you don't really need to like understand what the Denman claim is or what it was about. Like, it's not like, I feel like even a lot of us who were in the show was like, because the heroine Mabel Denman has her monologue about the claim in the beginning, and I think it's purposely like confusing and convoluted, and she goes on this whole thing about like, you know, 70 years ago,
right,
and like it's like this long thing,
this speech
so
about how the claim
I couldn't explain
be.
It to, I don't know, but like we all kind of like it's not really super important to like what I think the heart of the show like really is about, which is just kind of like, It's actually kind of like sad when you think about it, because like Preston Plum, like think about that now, like somebody writing like a play about how awesome like a politician is, and like everyone agrees, and then it just tours and everyone's like, this is a great politician because he was like a man of the people, and we just don't, you know.
Well, it was a simpler time in American politics, certainly, and Plum, as a man of the people, as you say, who was a populist and very much, I think, you know, representative of the spirit of the time. You know, he was an optimist. He was He was progressive. He was forward-looking. He was trying to develop railroads and mining and you know, infrastructure throughout the country. This was a formidable man.
Right.
And you know, he was lost to history, and Joanna found him again. It was here's Joanna's book.
Go buy it.
The Forgotten Senator. Yeah, you can buy this book at her website. Right. We'll put up that information.
Yeah.
For y'all later, but definitely go and check out this book, and we'll also make the play available on our website as well, in case anybody's interested in checking that out.
It's really funny.
Yeah, it is definitely an artifact of its time, and we think that it would work very well on community theater stages, like the way we did it.
Just like cut it so it's not 4 hours.
Well, that's definitely it was actually almost 3.5 hours in its total running time.
Yeah.
We cut it a little bit, but our task in being funded by the Joint Powers Board of the City of Casper was to reproduce this thing in its original context. So to try to give the audience a sense of what this would have been like back in the day, what it would have been like for an audience. Say, even in a town like Casper in the 19th century, which had a touring house, where productions and performers would frequently stop on tour, what it would have been like had this play come to this town. So we ended up performing it at Natrona County High School, which has an old-style auditorium that was built in 1920. So that's typical of the kind of theater facilities that were being erected at the time. It's a full ornate proscenium arch in the grand style of the 19th century. And so the play looked beautiful in that auditorium. It looked really, really nice and gorgeous costuming appropriate to the period.
Mm-hmm.
And also we reproduced the acting style of the melodrama as well, which if you want to get a sense of what that was like, check out any silent movie, because the acting style carries over from the silent era, the melodramatic period of the 19th century over into silent movie acting. So what was some of your experiences, Josie Armstrong?
I don't know if I'll ever be able to act like normally again. It's very over the top, and it's like pretty campy. And it's also very unserious, but it deals with serious things sometimes. Like, characters have complicated emotions for each other. It's not like...
You're the love interest.
Yeah. And it's like surface level, like in the dialogue, because we're like silly and, you know, but if you like really think about these things, like it's kind of like, some of it's kind of like intense, you know?
Yeah. I mean, did you find it challenging as an actor?
Like, I don't know, at times, but it was really, I think it's almost easier to go and like, but my character was like kind of like specific, because my character was like acting a fool, like, and that was like what was fun about it, is I could kind of just like not really have to like think about like how my, like, is this the face that a normal person would be making when you're listening, you know what I mean? Like, I could just stand there and go like, and it's like, and it doesn't really matter. Whereas like in other roles that I've played, you kind of have to like, with like naturalism, it's like you think about it, which makes it like less natural. But with Josie and this kind of melodramatic acting style, you're not really in your head as much about like how you like being like an actual person. You're a caricature of a person.
Yes, a caricature of a person.
There's not
type,
that
basically.
Expectation, to be any type of way. You're just kind of like a goof.
Well, it's very much in line with the tradition in theater history of the stock characters.
Mm-hmm.
It goes back to the Greek and Roman comedy.
Mm-hmm.
You have these fixed types of characters that actors would play.
Right.
And they would play these roles in more or less the same way. The villain is the villain is the villain, and the hero is the hero is the hero.
Yeah.
You know, until Ibsen comes along and flips that over in A Doll's House. But the challenge for the actors, I guess, is to make it fresh, you know, over and over again, and not to seem as corny as it is.
Right.
Because the back of the hands of the forehead gesture showing distress is something that you did at one moment in the play, but it was very effective at the moment that you did it.
Thank you. I think it's also kind of like
it didn't look like a caricature. It looked like, okay, you know, this is this is what the acting style looked like. This is what they would have done, you know, and you were, you know, authentically in the moment there.
Thank you. I think everybody in the cast was really good at, like, diving into that. And it's also because it's not really, like, something that you, like, see a whole lot of. Like, there's, like, Pride and Prejudice, like, stuff, you know? But this was, like, super unique. And it can be difficult, too, to, like, go over the top, like, with the naturalism. Like, that's hard in its own right. But also, like, when you have to be, like, super, like, kind of stupid and deliver these lines, like, and it's really campy, that is also hard, because you have to kind of, like, let go of yourself and just, like, and be stupid.
Yeah, and not feel self-conscious.
Yeah,
about it.
Yeah,
like your character had, your dialogue was rife with all of this period slang.
That doesn't make any sense. And I looked up some of these words, and there was, like, literally nothing. Google said no results.
For things like chromolecued?
Chromolecued was the exact word that I Googled that had nothing to show for it.
What about kajiggered? Kajiggered is a term that...
Well, because that's like a tool that you can use, like, with, like...
Kajiggered usually has to do with, like a thing or an object.
Yeah.
But
some of them, it didn't really make sense in the way that my character was even using them, I don't think.
Limp gobbled. But maybe there was no record, on the internet of that. But it could very well be. And I'd be interested to know if that was actual slang that people were using in the period.
That is hysterical to imagine.
Well, I've read novels from that period, like, you know, Theodore Dreiser's An American Tragedy, which is set in that time. And, you know, the dialogue that he writes was, you know, is reminiscent of the way in which the people talked in those days. And there was more formality to their speech, and there was a little bit more of a sense of you know, presentation of the self. And, you know, nowadays people really don't care and don't think about those things. But, you know, things like diction and elocution were studied, and so that was part of that would be part of, you know, what an actor would imbibe of representing these characters on stage.
Well, it's interesting that you bring that up, because, like, when Vince and I were doing our scenes, and just when everybody, like, there are certain jokes that were, like, lost on us for, like, a long time, because it doesn't make sense in, like, the context of our society. Like, for example, my love interest, Vince, Mr. Vance, played by Vincent. There's a scene where towards the end we become more familiar with each other, and we finally, he asked me, can I call you by your first name? And so in every single line in the scene, we call each other by our first name. So I keep saying Richard, and he keeps saying Josie over and over again. And when we were reading it, it's kind of like, why do they keep saying each other's names? Like, this is, like, awkward and weird. But then it finally occurs to me, like, oh, it's funny because, like, they've never done that before.
Yes.
It's, like, exciting
yes.
to, like, use each other's fucking first names. And I finally, like, caught on to that. And there was a lot of stuff like that where I'm like, oh, this is supposed to be funny because people are, like, weird and formal in this time period. And,
right,
like,
and they're going to a new level of intimacy.
It's very strange.
Yes. No, but you've got it.
It's, like, also, like, super sexist, and which I think, like, we, and a lot of those things, like, it doesn't age well, but I think we handled it pretty well, like, because we recognized, like, that it was a product of its time, like, certain lines, like, about, like, Mr. Ling Ching had a line about, like, women, like, they don't kiss before they get married or, like, something like
no,
that.
No, Leeching,
like,
was talking about...
What was that? It was a scene with me.
Wasn't Leeching was talking about the Chinese traditions of women not seeing, even being allowed to meet their husbands until
right,
the wedding
because
night.
He walked in on it on the kiss between
right.
Josie and Vance.
Which doesn't happen until you're married, right?
Yeah, which isn't supposed to, yet.
Right.
Yeah, so it's funny that we kind of, like, you know, would roll our eyes at, like, lines like that and...
we're touching on something, another important aspect of this play that we had to deal with, and that was the representation of the stage ethnics.
Oh.
You know, and also, you know, we had to deal with the sexism, and that's inherent in the play.
But also what's kind classism. Of funny, absolutely, is like the play is sexist, but also like the most intelligent characters are the women, or at least Mrs. Hillary, because it's funny because Hannibal gets kind of like all of the credit for like saving the day at the end, whereas like it was Mrs. Hillary because she uses her,
she's the one who comes through in the clutch.
With the key idea
yes. that's necessary.
She like
to turn
kisses
the whole
letter
around.
And like gives it to who it needs to go to,
right.
And then everybody gets saved.
They get Senator Keene off the
because
podium so that they
the
can
judge is
going to
go on a date with her or something like that. Yeah, yeah, whatever. Whereas in everybody at the end of that scene is like,
yeah,
Hannibal. Like me and Hillary would look at each other like,
yeah,
you did it, girl.
We have a lot to do with it ourselves, girl. Yes. Indeed.
Yeah. So that was like pretty cool. It always kind of bothered me that Hannibal Rivers ended up with Mabel.
Yeah. Why?
Because I definitely think he should have been with Mrs. Hillary. Well, they're more like they have like a very like intellectual relationship, and they like they bounce off of each other really well. Whereas Mabel is kind of like.
Yes.
This like, girl, you know, like, she's sweet, nothing against, and I love Mabel.
No, she would be, but
basically, like, she was more, I don't know.
Oh, so I think she's more of an ideal sort of wife or a guy like Rivers, or maybe Plum in real life, who was such an incredibly forceful personality. You know, a lot of these politicians, you know, at least they in the old days, the idea of, you know, politicians' wives were supposed to stay in the background. And, you know, not make themselves apparent and just to be pretty and, you know, be there at social gatherings and so forth.
Which is unfortunate because the obvious match was Mrs. Hillary, especially because for the entirety of the show, they are like, you know, what is the word? They're like in cahoots.
Yes,
they're like working
conspiring.
Together. Yeah. Whereas Mabel is kind of just like off to the side, like dealing with her own like,
dealing with her
family
father,
drama.
Elderly father,
and they don't really even get to know each other all that well. Like, so, yeah, that always kind of bothered me. But it's a wonderful, wonderful play.
Yeah, and the stage ethics, you know, was an issue or at least a phenomenon, a performance convention of the 19th century. Stage ethics were built on the stereotypes of the many people that were emigrating from other countries to the United States. And whatever ethnic minority you could find in New York City at that time or in any major city in this country, you could expect to find actors that were impersonating those stereotypes.
Yeah, in the Senator, there's a German count,
right?
Which is like, you know, offensive, and then Ling Qing, which is also it is in today's, but certain there's like kind of like this spectrum of like what's ultimately just completely unacceptable and doesn't serve the play in any way and is just kind of in there to be.
Well, the argument could have been made that we had no business using Ashton Capps to play Ling Qing.
Right, that's a whole completely
other. Not an
Asian
person.
Right, that was another conversation.
But I think it's.
But
apropos of the play though, that you know we have.
Right, but what was completely unacceptable, we cut out. You know.
Well, yeah, I mean the representation of. To Hannibal Rivers' body servant, Erastus, which was done in the typical, very offensive, racially stereotyped minstrel kind of look that they gave to this character, and the way the speech patterns and all.
No,
there was no, then that character would have been played by an actor in blackface. On in the
1890s, which is just something that
there's
no reason for it.
I agree. So I mean, the easiest thing to do was to cut the character,
right? Because what we did with that was because I mean, Erastus really only had a couple of lines where he was acting as like an assistant to Rivers, so
right.
We just gave those lines to Rivers' actual assistant in the play, which was Mr. Vance, and he covered that.
The grayer area, though, was Ling Qing. Who was essentially a stage Chinaman back in the 1890s, who was played by a white man in yellowface.
Right, which we did not do never have done.
Well, we did put the actor in yellowface, but we did put the actor in the costume that would have been stereotypically associated with a Chinese person of the period.
The difference between Ling Qing and Erastus was that Ling Qing was not, like, it didn't, like, punch down, if that makes sense. Like, Ling Qing was like He was really important to the plot in the sense that he's like a respected like politician and is like
he's an ambassador from
China. So he's super like entwined with everybody in the play with his plots and it's not like whereas Erastus it was just kind of like it's just so obviously like meant to be super super offensive and like it just wasn't like it's not like it wasn't respectful in any way.
Right.
And Lin Ching is more kind of just like he's his own person. He's not like just like this horrible stereotype and caricature of the time. Like
yeah.
He's like an actual character with like motivations and
yes.
Like yeah.
Yeah, and represented I think with dignity, even though he was the
like it's obvious it's still offensive like in its own right like you know like a lot of us like read it and it's like and we didn't say certain slang words that were in the show
yes.
Like we took those out because they're super offensive but his character as a whole was like pretty like
yeah
like I said he was like his own person
we didn't all we did was darken Ash's hair and we didn't do anything with eye makeup to make the eyes look slanty or anything like that and we didn't even change the complexion of Ash's skin. But we had the actor do it all with the lines, with the dialogue, and with the voice that approximated what actors like Sidney Toller or Peter Lorre or Werner Olin would have done with the Charlie Chan character. The stage ethnics problem, I think, was something that we handled very nicely and tastefully. It continues to be a problem, though, in the theater about who gets to represent who.
Oh,
and we don't have to get that. I'll save that for another discussion, but it is a very pressing issue in the theater today. As far as the project goes, as a collaboration among the different companies in town, that was also very valuable, I thought. And it was good that the city and various civic entities saw that and were able to contribute the money that they contributed to make this happen and for all of us to get paid for what we did, which was also quite wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
And this ties in also to the advocacy I've been preaching lately for actors being paid for what they do and for even and especially at the local level for actors to stop thinking about themselves as amateurs and volunteers and to start thinking more of themselves in terms of people who are providing a professional grade service in some instances, many instances. So there was that, and we had that satisfaction and working together and pooling the resources, we got to see each other and work with each other. And that was very good for
experience.
Us as a theater community all around. Yeah.
It was really fun.
So, So thank you, Johanna Wickman, wherever you are.
Probably
in the wilds
we
of,
miss you.
Probably in the wilds of Kansas someplace. On your book tour.
Being awesome.
This is the book, The Forgotten Senator, The Life and Character of Preston.
Look at that handsome guy.
B. Plum. And on our website, www.theaterofthepoor.org, we will be posting the PDF of the script that we use. So if anybody that's listening to this would like to peruse it, is welcome to do so. And we do own the rights to it. So please, if you want to stage it, you can contact us. But in the meantime, we think that it's something that ought not to be forgotten for another 100 years. Because that play was off the radar.
Put on Netflix.
It doesn't even show up in the anthologies of the best plays of the period, and you have to like really dig through New York Times reviews and other newspapers of the period in order to find references to this thing. So.
It was so popular.
It was famous in its day. Played by one of the great American actors of his time, William H. Crane. Nor should The Forgotten Senator be forgotten as well.
Yeah,
because
he did so many cool things.
Yeah, which you can read about in Johanna's book, and it was really an exciting opportunity to excavate this artifact from the 19th century and be able to realize it and reproduce it and give a modern audience a sense of what it was like to go to the theater for 3 hours back in the 19th century.
Well, yeah, it was long.
It was long. That was
really
some,
long.
For the point of view of a 21st century audience that's been pretty much weaned on
TikTok
videos.
Well, back then they didn't have shit to do. Like, they could go like sit in the theater like for a million hours.
Well, yeah, and in order to capture that, we managed to get the, you know, we had the reenactors come in and people dressed in 19th century costume to have
really
a night on the town. Yeah, there was a lot of cool stuff, and I built all of that into the stage directions for the adaptation that we hope to make available to the public very soon.
We should normalize talking directly to the audience more in plays, because that was just really, really fun.
Yeah.
Like, the asides.
Yes.
I used to hate asides.
I know that. You used to hate it. As an audience member, you used to hate it. Right?
Well, and even especially as an actor, because it's like, I'm breaking immersion, but it's like... Everyone knows it's a play.
Of course.
Like, we don't, I'm not fooling
but
anybody.
It depends
here.
On the play. I mean, asides to the audience don't work if you're doing O'Neill. You know, it's.
But, like, you could. Like, you're.
I'm going to keep drinking until I die. And he can't do a damn thing about it. What do you think about that? It doesn't work
exactly.
In an O'Neill play unless it's a comedy. But
no.
Yeah, but the aside, putting
I've,
it more.
I've grown to love the aside.
It is a wonderful way of connecting with the audience. And remember that the fourth wall, theater history.
Looking people in
students of theater history, the fourth wall does not exist before the 19th century and the invention of the box set.
What?
Yeah, the box set with the three walls and the fourth wall removed so that you can look in on the slice of life.
Oh.
But that's the subject for another podcast. Okay, because we're going off the rails here tonight. So. This is Bill and Julia signing off. Peace, y'all. We love you. Go to the theater. Support your local.